May peace and grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. May I take this opportunity to welcome you to 2021 Woodlands Conference Camp Meeting. Admittedly, 2021 and 2020 have been very difficult years because of COVID-19. Most of our brothers and sisters succumbed to COVID and are resting, waiting for the soon coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. We have called different speakers who will teach us and preach to us in this year's camp meeting. It is for this reason that I ask you in your busy schedule to find time to listen to the messages that have been prepared specifically for you under the theme, Now is the Time. Welcome, dear friends, and God be with you.
Brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 2021 Woodlands Conference Virtual Camp Meeting. This is the time we've been waiting for, and finally it's here, day number one. The theme says, Now is the Time. And what a theme to celebrate. We have lined up a number of programs for you. Talk about music, lessons birthed in the Word of God, discipleship, issues of membership retention. Yes, we'll be featuring a health nugget just for you. And later, as we proceed towards the end, God has planned for you this year to be able to receive His divine will, messages from biblical preaching by His servant, Dr. Tommy Namitondo. And so it is our prayer that you will enjoy these meetings, 4 days with our God. We invite you, night after night, every evening, to invite a brother, to invite a sister. It's a time for fellowship, a time for prayer. It's a time to celebrate God's goodness. And by the way, never forget, every camp meeting gives you a chance and a choice to give a thanksgiving offering to God. And so plan that through your local church. And now sit back, relax, as you enjoy the Woodlands Conference 2021 Virtual Camp Meeting. Now is the time.
Let us pray. Our gracious Lord and Father who is in heaven, a moment like this one has been awaited for a very long time, from the time we had a camp meeting. And this time, Heavenly Father, we pray that what you have authorized to happen, you may supervise and lead. And we pray that all the programs that are going to take place during this camp meeting and even in the day of today, there may be programs that are going to be approved by heaven. We call upon you, heavenly hosts, to come and protect your people from the influence of the enemy, and that your will and your will alone may be done today, because we pray all in Jesus' name, our Lord. Amen.
Hello, church. My name is Luomba Makasese. As the children are here to give you a presentation on spiritual gift. Before we start, allow me to give you a song. Are you standing at the crossroad, wondering which road you should take, and you're dreading the decision and that is never too far from wherever you are.
Hello, Saints of the Living God. Me and my friends are here to give you a presentation on spiritual gifts. My name is Elisheba Inkumbumwenya.
My name is Ruth Mwangala.
My name is Tabi Somasomo.
Each of us has one body with many parts, and the parts do not have the same purpose. So we are many persons, but in Christ we are one body, and all the parts of the body belong to all the other parts. We all have gifts, but they differ in keeping with the grace that God has given each of us. Do you have a gift or preaching, then use it in keeping with the faith you have. Do you have a gift of surf? Then surf. Is it teaching? Then teach. Romans 12 verse 4 to 6. Thank you.
Now is the time. Indeed, it's time for us as children to understand spiritual gifts. What is a spiritual gift? A spiritual gift is something God has chosen specifically for you so that you can help with the advancement of the church on earth by serving and using your special ability. 1 Corinthians 12 verse 4 says, there are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit is the source of them all. God could have chosen angels to speak to the lost humanity, but no, he chose you, our parents, and us children to do his work among humankind. As we seek to follow and be used by Jesus Christ, we need to utilize all that he has made available to us. If you can sing, then sing with might. If you have the gift of knowledge, then educate the church. If it's wisdom, use it.
Now is the time. It is a time to know that God has given each of you a gift from his great variety of spiritual gifts. Use them well to serve one another. 1 Peter 4 verse 10, spiritual gifts are to be used. If you let a gift go unused, you will be disobeying God and cheating the church for a blessing. For this reason, we must use the gift that God has given us. Each spiritual gift has a special place in the body of Christ. Every gift that God has given us, which has been placed in the body of Christ, which is the church, is important. Some gifts, such as preaching, may seem more important than others, such as hospitality or service. But God has given us all these gifts to build up his church. None of these gifts should be looked down upon. There are many gifts like giving, healing, helping, and many others. So let none hear you idly saying, I don't have a spiritual gift. Our mothers, our fathers, now is the time to help us to know our spiritual gift. Thank you.
Bye.
I greet you all in the name of the Lord. Today we're going to talk about a topic that has been doing the rounds on the social media, a topic everyone has an opinion about. The topic is the issue of COVID vaccination. Now, we as a church have not been spared, and we have equally been subject to a lot of theories, a lot of thoughts on the COVID vaccine. But the question is, has the church left us to battle it on our own, to figure out what to follow, what not to follow? Or does the church actually have a position on vaccination? That is what we're going to find out today. As a background, we'll mention that ultimately, as Seventh-day Adventists, we look forward to the return of Christ, and we know that it was only when Christ will return that all suffering, all illness, and all dying will come to an end. But between now and then, we have been blessed with a health message. And that health message is based on the Bible, it is based on the spirit of prophecy, and it is based on evidence-based health science peer-reviewed. Furthermore, we know that the health message is merely a summary of all the healthful living aspects that we need to have in order for us to make it as we wait for eternity. Now, Ellen White who wrote The Spirit of Prophecy, wrote a lot on health, and some people might want to know that in actual fact, when she was alive, she equally lived through a pandemic like we are living through. In her time, the pandemic was smallpox, and the people of her time equally came up with a vaccination. And you might want to know that Ellen White actually took that vaccination herself. Then we have some people who have a school of thought that will say, oh, but some of the ingredients they put are from unclean animals. We don't eat unclean animals. Well, there is that issue for some people, but the church has looked at it, and using the Biblical Research Institute, in December of 2020, the church issued a statement to say that the rules that are given in Leviticus chapter 11, 1 to 20, and chapter 17, 11 to 12, forbidding the consumption of unclean food and blood, do not apply to the vaccinations, because a vaccine is not prepared as food. It is prepared as a medicine, as a life-preserving agent. So those rules do not come into play there, because we're not talking about a vaccination as something to eat. Other people have said the vaccination, the COVID vaccine, is a fulfillment of the mark of the beast. And as a church who have the three angels' message, we know that the end time controversy will center on the fourth commandment. We know that the mark of the beast will not be a literal physical mark, but it will be an issue of allegiance to a power that is being represented by the beast. So we cannot say that when I get a COVID vaccination, then I've gotten the mark of the beast, because the mark of the beast is not a health issue, but one on our loyalty to God. So in short, what is the position of the church? I'll read a statement as it was issued, which says, we encourage responsible immunization or vaccination, and we have no religious or faith-based reason not to encourage our adherents to responsibly participate in protective and preventive immunization programs. We value the health and safety of the population, which includes the maintenance of herd immunity. So that is the position. But it goes on to say in the same statement that, however, the church is not the conscience of the individual church member. And the church recognizes the right of each individual to make a choice. And these choices are exercised at individual level. So the choice to be immunized or not should not be seen as a dogma or a doctrine of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And I have put the references of where that statement is coming from. So in short, the church encourages us to responsibly take part in vaccination programs, but it does not force us to do so. It gives us the evidence, it gives us the science and the encouragement. But ultimately, you and I can make our own decision, but we should not do it from a point of not knowing what our church position is. Thank you very much.
Indeed.
Greetings, Woodlands Conference. My topic for today is single parenting. Before we get into single parenting, I want us to look at God's ideal for parenting. Genesis 2:18. It is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper comparable to him. Verse 24 says, therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall be one flesh. God's ideal for parenting is for both parents to be there throughout the child's life. But what has gone wrong? Why are we even having to think of discussing single parenting today? Maybe there's been death of spouse, divorce, pregnancies outside of wedlock, failing to find a partner to marry, which leads to desperation among people, and they end up adopting a child or going for artificial insemination. Or one parent abandoned by the other, leaving a parent to single parent the children alone. So what? since the devil has stepped in, and really the devil has won, we have to exist. Number one, we need to deal with what you need to deal with in you as a single parent. Take care of you as a parent. Single parent families are also complete families, and the church needs to take note of that. At times, we make it harder for single parent to parent effectively because as a church, we tend to segregate them. But let's bear in mind that single parent families are complete families as well. First, you need to accept the situation that you found yourself in. Avoid throwing pity parties or playing the why me game. Deal with your emotions and accept what led you to becoming a single parent. If you had a child outside of wedlock, forgive yourself completely because God forgives even the worst sinner. If it's death of spouse, deal with your grieving process without making children feel it's their fault that you are depressed. Don't make the children feel they are the cause of the financial wars that you are going through. In other words, deal with your emotional pain to avoid letting it out on children. Biblical role of a parent does not change just because you are a single parent. It remains the same. Proverbs 22:6 says, "Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it." The biblical role of a parent is to be a good steward for what God has entrusted to us. A parent has the responsibility to care for the spiritual, emotional, and physical well-being of their children, regardless of whether you're a single parent or a complete home. The most important biblical duty of a parent is to teach children about Jesus in action, leading by example. Let's look at the standard operating procedures of single parenting. Number one, accept that you don't own the children. God does. You are a custodian to train up these children for heaven. Very important point. The first thing, accept that these children are not yours. They are God's children. Mark 10:13-16 says it all. "And they were bringing children to him that he might touch them, and the disciples rebuked them." That's how important these children are to God. "But when Jesus saw it, he was indignant and said to them, 'Leave the children to come to me. Do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. Truly, I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter heaven.' And he took them in his arms and blessed them." The owner was only taking control of what belongs to him. What does this call for? It calls for walking the talk as a single parent. You can't tell your children not to swear when you are swearing. You can't tell your children not to drink or smoke when you are smoking. You can't tell your children not to have sex outside of marriage. When you are bringing men and women in the house and you tell them, "This is uncle and auntie," and you spend uncle and auntie within the bedroom. You can't tell them you have no money when you are buying new things every day for yourself. You can't tell the children not to sleep out when you are sleeping out or coming home early hours, leading by example. Remember, these children belong to God. Yours is to guide them in the truth. Ezekiel 18:4 says, "Behold, all souls are mine." There's no exception. "As the soul of the Father, so also the soul of the Son is mine." God clearly is telling us that these children are his. Matthew 18:10 says, "See that you do not despise one of these little ones, For I tell you that in heaven their angels see the face of my Father who is in heaven. Psalms 24:1 says, the earth and everything in it, the world and its inhabitants belong to the Lord. And he is not making an exception. David is saying everything, including these children. Number two, see them as your source of joy and comfort. Proverbs 10:1 says, a wise son makes a glad father, but a foolish son brings grief to his mother. Share moments of their success and share your moments of your success with your children. Affirm them so they know they are doing well. Avoid raising your voice when they have erred. Tell them gently. Gentle rebuke. Do not dump them on family because you can't deal with the issues of parenting. However, do not spare the rod and spoil the child. Discipline them because they need to face the world tomorrow when you are not there. Proverbs 13:24 says, whoever spares the rod hates his son, but he who loves him is diligent to discipline him. Do not spare the rod. Number three, nurture them spiritually. We are looking at operating procedures of a single parent. Lead them to Jesus and not to church. What am I talking about? When my kids were young, somebody commented and said, you know, the problem that we have is that we take our children to church and not to God. So lead them to Jesus and not to church. Guide them to find Jesus as a true parent, friend, comforter, and guide. And don't force them. Pray that they meet Jesus themselves. Take them to church so they can find Jesus there and not the building or friends. Some children take time to know Jesus spiritually. But if you did not miss out on training them in the way they should go for the first few years of their lives, they will come back. Your role is to pray for them. Nurture them in discipline and instruction of the Lord. Ephesians 6:4 says, and you fathers do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and admonition of the Lord. That's what Paul is telling us in his letter to the Ephesian church. Number four, love them without any conditions attached. Let them be children. Let children be children. Do not let the extremities of our strengths, of our perfectionism, spoil the childhood of a child. Leave those children, to be dirty at times, to play around. Not that if they want to play around, not that they should be reckless, but you are so worried about things sitting in the right place in the house that the children feel at home in their own home. They'll go find it elsewhere. Show love even when it's difficult to show love. Yes, there are times as a parent. Children do things that hurt to the bone. But love conquers all. Love will bring them back. Do not promise if they do something good that you give them something, a carrot stick type of parenting. And when they achieve what you expected, you do not give them. Don't make empty promises. I want to put a caveat here. Be careful not to develop a parenting style of a carrot stick, where you are promising children carrots as a reward for doing well in school, for excelling. This type of behavior continues even in the workplace. even as they become responsible in their homes. If they are not affirmed by a partner, it becomes an issue. Teach them that excelling is not for the good of you as a parent, it's for their own good. What are the challenges of single parenting? Number one, if you have no one to share your parenting challenges with, you will feel alone. Loneliness is a reality of life when you're a single parent. Do not hide your head in the sand. This is real. Remember, whenever you feel lonely, you are despairing, you are not alone. You have a God by your side. Children are not ours, remember that. They are for God. God is expecting us to bring them up for Him, for heaven. God is expecting us to bring them up to be responsible children. Give them back to the owner when it's heavy in prayer. Just tell God, God, these are your children, they are not mine. This is too heavy, I can't handle it, take over. Number two, society will judge you for failing to keep your marriage. Society will judge you for the reason why you are a single parent or for failing to discipline your children. The Bible tells us, be strong and of good courage. And if you are heavy laden, bring it at my foot. Be strong and be yourself. Don't allow the world around you to dictate your world and how you live. Remember, you can't please everyone. In trying to please everyone, you will please no one. Be you and not anyone else. Be the person God wants you to be, not what your neighbors want you to be. Do not look at how Jane's children behave compared to yours. Those are your children. Number three, accept that loneliness is real. You are human. You need companionship. It's in that finding companionship where we fail to live by example to our children. You can socialize all you can, but at the end of the day, you come home to nothing. That's loneliness. Spend 8 hours at work, and as you approach home, you are alone. Reality strikes that, hey, I am parenting these children by myself. Accept that your extended family may be keeping and your children can never take the place of emptiness that you are feeling. Your extended family, once in a while, will come in, the kids might visit, but it does not take that emptiness in you. Also, bear in mind that the children are also feeling empty and pressure, that actually they only have one parent. Accept that this is the reality of single parenting. Loneliness is not just unique to you as a parent, it's unique even to the children. Only God fills that vacuum. Remain focused on the duty ahead of you. Do not waver or give in to why me. Tell yourself, with God, I can make it. Number four. Reality is that you are the only one earning. The other spouse may be dead, or if divorced, not responsible. So financially, you are the only parent that could be providing financial support to the children. Explain to the children reality on the ground that finances will not be the same as when both of you were together. If the children are small, they will compare a lot with friends at school. Explain to the children and teach them to accept what they have and not to compare. Do not spoil them by making them believe you have the money and you can get whatever they want. You see, that's the other extreme of single parenting. You want to make up for the loneliness in the kids as well, for that gap in the kids, so that they don't start finding, you know, comparing with other children and feeling like they don't have enough. And you end up spoiling them. You will end up in debt. So do not spoil them. Be open about your financial situation. You don't have, you don't have. When you have, you provide. It also teaches the children to manage the extravagant appetites. Live within your limits, even you yourself. Do not be in a habit of, Grace or John has got a new handbag, I need to go buy one for myself. And yet the school fees for the children have not been paid. You end up going to get a loan to pay fees for the children because you've got 20 handbags in the house. Go sell the handbags and pay fees for the kids. Number five, there is a lot of emotional toil in us as the parent, whether you are a single parent or a parent in a complete home. Parenting is not for cowards. It's not an easy job. Worse still when you are parenting alone. You have a lot of emotional toil, a lot of questions, a lot of fears. Will I make it? Am I doing a good job? For one thing, you can't be both. Remember, when the spouse was around, there was a sense of security. But now, you are alone. You have to provide that security to the children. Whether it's divorce or death, there is a period of grieving that spouses go through. Accept that. As you accept that as a spouse, you are going through grieving, remember that the children are also grieving. Do not make drastic decisions during the grieving process. You will make decisions out of emotions. Moving town, country, is only running away from dealing with a loss. You will find the loss waiting for you when you come back. Deal with it while you are with your children. Number six, at times, it may be difficult to instill discipline in the children, especially if you are where you were seen as the kinder of the two when still with your spouse. You know, the problem with parenting is that children are very good at manipulating when you are both there. They always want to make the other parent kinder. You discipline and they say, Daddy, Mommy spanking me. And the daddy goes and scolds Mommy. Mommy, Daddy spanking me. And Mommy goes and scolds Daddy. They like to work parents against each other. This time, they only have you. So if you were the kinder one, when you were still together, kids will take advantage. Remember, you are alone. Be firm in your discipline. Do not compromise. Remember, you are a single parent. Now, both mother and father, be man enough to assist even the opposite sex of a child. Establish values you want your children to grow up with and remain firm. Seven. Single parenting mixed with professional demands can be stressful, ending up venting out the stress on the children. Remember, you are alone. You are the only one earning. And as such, you come home tired. Don't vent out the frustrations of work on the children. If you are failing to handle it, realize you may need extra help. Seek counseling. You don't want to make children feel guilty and scared. Take care of the you. Exercise. Seek support groups, friends, or prayer teams, those that can constructively build you. Eat healthy. Stress causes us to eat junk. Eat healthy. Get enough sleep. Spoil yourself once in a while to unwind. Over the weekend, tell the children you want a bit of rest, so if they can give you time to rest. Even as you seek counseling, and hear me right, even as you seek counseling, do not clutch on to the counselor. That is a formula for falling. Be professional in your receiving counseling. You are taking care of the how to handle stress and not looking for a shoulder to lean on. Your mental health is what you are looking for. Avoid being close to the counselor. You will never be able to handle single parenting alone. Accept that. But don't clutch where every little thing you are calling the counselor. Put into practice what the counselor is telling you. Number 8, watch out for the empty nest. As the children grow, let go. Not letting go will result in becoming difficult when the children want to get married. You say no to every partner that the child brings because you are afraid of letting go. You find faults in every partner that your child brings because you want that child to marry you, somebody like you. You are protecting the child. Thinking that the children don't care for you, why are they rushing to leave home? Developing negative feelings and behaviors towards the spouse. Remember, the children will grow and need to start their own lives. Be ready for that. In closing, above all, develop a positive mindset. This will help while building a new kind of family for you and your children. Stop feeling sorry for yourself. You are not the only single parent. And remember, the children are not yours. You are only a custodian. It's a privilege for God to entrust children in our hands. They are God's children. You are only a good steward. Ask the owner of the children to guide you as you parent them alone for his kingdom. Find mentors among God-fearing men who can help you mentor the boy children if you are a female single parent. Find mentors among God-fearing women who can mentor your child if you are a male single parent. Above all, with God, remember, there is nothing impossible. You can one day look back and say, "Thank you, Lord, for walking with me as a single parent." You would have fought a good fight and won the race. And hear Jesus himself say, "Well done, my child." Thank you.
I greet you, my beloved brothers and sisters. Yes, Woodlands Conference. Our topic is very important. Challenges faced by the Adventist youth. Challenges faced by the Adventist youth. I'm going to give you few of them because there are so many. I'm going to give you few of them. As a matter of fact, I'm going to share with you only 3 challenges faced by the Adventist youth. So I'm going to share with you only 3. The first one I'm going to share with you is the emotional baggage. Emotional baggage. The second one, sexual temptation. That's the second one. And the third one that I'm going to share with you is the battle for the mind. These are the 3 challenges that the Adventist youth are faced with, and that is basically the emotional baggage, sexual temptations, and the third one I'm going to share with you is battle for the mind. Now, beloved, I want you to understand, that when you think of the emotional baggage, basically this is just a metaphor that refers to unprocessed things in one's life, negative things for that matter, which are not processed, which still remain in someone's mind. Those kind of things are the ones referred to as the emotional baggage. Let me share this with you, that actually every human being has emotional baggage. The only difference is there are some who are ruled by these emotional baggage. In other words, the choices they make are actually based on this emotional baggage. What could this be? Let me share with you a few of them. One that I can mention is anger. So they got angry at one time in their past, and that anger was not resolved. The issue that angered them was not resolved. And that thing could continue on in their lives. The other one are fears, okay? And they, because of those fears, what they went through, you find that those same fears are still following them. Yet they have moved on for a number of years after that, but the fears are still following them. Of course, there's another one which is something more serious, which when somebody comes out of something traumatic, maybe he witnessed it or he was even a part of it. And those are things that you find feed this emotional baggage. And the people, this person has this emotional baggage. And these things can affect the person indeed. The other one is guilt. Yes, guilt. There are times when a young person, when he was still probably a teenager and so on, or still even younger, did something, and he has not forgiven himself or herself of that thing. And that guilty is still with him or her. And that emotional baggage has affected the youths. And why is it so? Because sometimes some of these youths don't want to open up to these things. And because of that, the weight is still on the youth for a long, long time. The other one is regret. You find there's something they did and they regret about it. And that regret is still following them for a number of years later. And if it is not resolved, that emotional baggage can actually inform what they are going to do each time they are faced with choices to make. And so it's very, very important for us to look at this. It's very, very important for us to understand this. It's very, very important for the Adventist youth also to know, because there are some who don't even know why they make certain silly decisions. Yet it is all because of the emotional baggage which they have. Others is because of rejection. Others is because of rejection. You find here's a young person, is taught by the mother to say, you know what, by the time you were born, your father had told me he's not responsible for the pregnancy, and off he left, he abandoned us, and so on. That rejection will be with this child. The mother may not know, but that rejection will be with this child, and for the rest of his life, for the rest of her life, if he doesn't get help, he will be having this particular issue. And because of that, you find that even for them to be in a relationship, this young person will have trouble in a relationship. Why? Because when the brother just says, today I'm busy, I'll call you tomorrow morning, the sister already sees rejection. So all I'm saying is the emotional baggage can affect the youth. And these are the challenges that the youth go through. The other one is the abuse. Abuse. Of course, rejection is part of the abuse, one of the worst actually abuses in the world. And then you have these abuse. I don't know what abuse it is, but these are things that a young person will go on in life and they'll still have these particular things, this baggage on them, this weight on them. The other one that I want to share with you is exploitation. You may find that maybe the young person was exploited when he was still young, and this is still there on him or her. Let me mention one which is really on my heart. This is when the child has no father figure in his life. And this is a big issue, especially for the boy child. It's also terrible for the girl child. But for the boy child, he needs a father to be there. A father as a role model. But yet the father is not there. And this becomes a challenge. This can also be part of the emotional baggage. And these are challenges that Adventist youths are facing. What could be the solution? The solution is this. That young people, when you have certain emotions within you, open up to someone. Talk to someone. Yes, talk to someone. Even in the church, we have at least somebody you respect. Talk to that person that you respect. All I could say, you can have mentors in your life. Once you have this mentor, this mentor will serve as a counselor, and that will help you a lot. That will help you a lot. Let's move to the next thing. We have covered emotional baggage as one of the challenges the young people are facing. The second one that I want to move to is sexual temptation. Yes. Sexual temptation is truly one of the challenges faced by the youths. And let me put it very clear here. Let me give a fact here. That sex is a fascinating and amazing gift from God. Yes, sex is a fascinating and indeed a wonderful, sweet gift from God. But you know what? A young person who is listening to me right now and you're watching me right now, I want you to know that sex is like fire. It can be a good servant in a relationship that is authorized by heaven, by the church, by the state, by the parents, and by the community. When these authorize you, then it will be a good servant for you. But if you want to do it without the authorization and the permission and the consent of God, your parents, the church, the state, the community, then the same sex will turn, instead of being a good servant, it will be a terrible master and it will burn you. Because let me put it very clear to you, so that you could just understand this. That you know what? Sex is a very terrible and notorious temptation that young people meet today. Yes. And I want you to also know that sex is something that can ruin your future. It can ruin your career. It can ruin your reputation. It can ruin your ministry. It can ruin your leadership. It can ruin your life completely. In even one single blow. And that's why you need to take care of this. And surely I've put it that this is a challenge faced by the Adventist youths. Let me put it this way. That an Adventist youth can break the Sabbath only one day of the week. Only once, one day of the week. Okay, like one day of the week. Only on Sabbath. Then a young person can break the Sabbath. But when it comes to sexual temptations, they'll come to the young person even seven times in one day. So that's why it's important for us to take care of this. It's important for us to raise this awareness and say, yes, this is a challenge and needs solution to this. Let me say this now. This one is specifically for you, the young man there. Yes, this one is for you, young man there. Yes, this one is for you. That you know what? Get the advice of Job. What did Job say? Job said that I have made a covenant with my eyes not to look at a woman lustfully. Job 31, verse 1. He says, I have made a covenant. That tells me, young man, that for you, your eyes can bring problems to you. Your eyes. And you know, it all starts with the eyes. Then gets to the last that Job mentioned, which is the mind. And then later, you want to become greedy to get things that don't even belong to you. To enjoy that which does not belong to you. And so that is the issue. But I want you to know something. That as a man, young man, you have a mountain to climb. You have battles to conquer. You have a future to build. You have a career to work on. You have a business to establish. You have a family to put in place. You have great things ahead of you. And God has great plans for your life. But I want you to know that if you don't take care of sexual temptations, you may lose all these things that God has in store for you. So, I want you to realize something. That if you ask them, older men and older women, they'll tell you that families have been destroyed because of yielding to sexual temptations. And you find that once the family is destroyed, a person can even say, I forgive you, it's okay. But yet to build that trust again becomes a problem. Becomes a problem. And one of the challenges I've seen among the young people, is the internet. Yes. Internet is a challenge among the young people. And I want to mention one of the challenges that come from the internet, and that is pornography. In the olden days, for somebody to watch any pornographic movie, they had to go to a particular cinema hall. But today, just on the phone, just a click away, that's where pornography is. And a young man, a young lady can have access to pornography. But I want you to know that this is something that has destroyed a lot of young people. Destroyed them in their relationships. Destroyed them emotionally. Destroyed them spiritually. Destroyed them even on their physical activities. Pornography. And it has been proved as one of the top time wasters. Allow me to mention that this has taken so much time among some of the young people that some of them, they are now addicted to pornography. Allow me to say this, that indeed, you can seek help and you find help. Don't die alone in silence. Just there where you're addicted to pornography and you want to die alone. No. Talk to someone and it shall be a blessing indeed. It shall be a blessing indeed. Others are also addicted to masturbation. And this is a challenge faced by the young people. Right now as I speak to you, I have a team of young people, 132 of them, who are addicted to these two things, pornography and masturbation, and we are on a journey with them to victory. And I'm just saying, this is real. It's not something that you can just ignore. It's something real. You need help if you are faced with that particular challenge. And you will be amazed how victorious you shall be out of it. There are others who are in trouble because of what is known as phone sex. Others is sexting. These are some of the challenges that the young people are facing today. There are some young people who are faced with not only the sexual relationships, but even the emotional relationships with other people. And this is indeed a problem. But I want you to know that today you can find help. You can find help. You can overcome that challenge. You can come out victorious over that particular challenge. Don't die alone. No, you can make it. And I am very positive about it, that you can make it. What is the solution to this? The solution to this is for you to know your identity. For you to know that you are a child of God. For you to know that for you as a child of God is not only to stay away from sexual intercourse or sexual sin, but for you, you need to know that you should also get to another level of the desiring sexual purity. Not only the act, but even your mind desiring sexual purity. And remember, your body is bought by the blood of Jesus. You're not of yourself. Remember that you're a child of God, and God created you for something great in your life. And for that reason, I want you to know that you can make it. You can make it. You can make it, and you shall be victorious. The third challenge that I want to share with you today, the third challenge is the battle for the mind. Yes, the battle for the mind. The battle for the mind. It must be very clear to us that when you think of an eagle, which is the national symbol of Zambia, when you think of an eagle, you think of the strong wings. When you think of an eagle, you think of this strong sight. And this is what God has given the eagle. And that's what makes the eagle different and unique from all the other animals. When you think of the lion, it's the king of the jungle, not because it is the most beautiful animal in the jungle. Not because it's the biggest animal in the jungle. By the way, let me shock you with this one. Not even because it's the fastest animal in the jungle. No, but all because of its courage. That's what God has given the lion. But let me tell you some good news. God has given man something that makes man unique from all these other animals. And that is the mind. The mind. God has given the mind to man, and that makes you, young person, to be unique and different from any other person. And no wonder when you look at the mind, God has protected the mind so well, deposited very well, sitting there on the brain there, and the brain is well protected there. And God has simply declared this is a no-go area. Even sharks should not go there, because the mind is what a human being is. We can change your wardrobe. We can even change your name. But if we don't change your mind, you still remain the same. And I want you to know that your identity, who you are, depends on just one thing. And that is your mind. Not your location, but just your mind. And therefore, I want you to understand that the devil knows this fact. And that's why whatever the devil brings is actually a fight. Not for your leg, a fight not for your hand, a fight simply for one thing, and that is your mind. Your mind. Your mind. Your mind. And the devil wants to fight your mind, because the devil knows that once he fights your mind and you have a particular way of looking at things, if the devil can change your mind, the way you consider certain things, then he has won you, because that way your identity will change. As a child of God, know this one thing, that what you have is nothing but the mind. And that's why young people are faced with this challenge. The battle for the mind. 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 Why do you think even those who are selling tires want to put pictures of young ladies that are not dressed properly for their advent? It's because they are targeting your mind. Because they know from your mind it will be easy for you to go to your wallet or to your purse. Their mind. There's another problem, another challenge under this issue of the battle for the mind that is faced with the young people. And that is the appetite for instant gratification. The appetite for instant gratification. A lot of young people want to have everything now. Everything now. Everything now. They don't want to wait for tomorrow. They want everything now. No wonder they can be involved in corruption because they want everything now. They can't wait because they want everything now. Now, now, now. Like in the now, now, now. And I don't know why it is like this with this generation. I don't know. Because we were told reliably that our parents would, even when they're in love, they would write each other letters. And somebody would wait for a month for a letter. And then they would respond and so on with letters and so on. And they were patient. But the generation of today, they want everything in the now. And this appetite for instant gratification is the one that has caused a lot of trouble. And that's why a young person would rather not read a book but watch a movie where the book is summarized. They want everything now. They want it easy. They want it in the now. And that's why many young people have a challenge even to be faithful. Today, even when you want to talk about virginity among the young people, they want to say, no, you are old-fashioned. Why? Because they want it now. They want it now. You tell them, hey, wait, you can only kiss her after your marriage during your honeymoon. No, they can't wait. They want it now. The appetite for instant gratification is the one that has caused so many problems. And that's the battle for the mind, because that's where choices are made. Choices are made in the mind. The mind. The mind. You know what Paul said? That when I was a child, I used to think like a child. I used to do everything like a child. That's what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 13, verse 11. He says, everything was that like a child. And then he mentions three things. He says, I used to speak like a child. I used to think like a child. And I used to reason and understand things like a child. But he says, when I became an adult, when I became an adult, I put away all these childish things. That tells you everything, even for you to be now a lady, fascinating woman, for you to be now a real man, everything has to do with your mind. It's not even your physique. It's not even your stage. It's your mind. It's your mind. And that is where now you have the understanding and the maturity to know that I can have this later. You have the maturity now to know that I can work for this and have it later. I can work for it for 5 years and have it later. You have that particular maturity because now you are grown. You are grown up now. The other one which is a challenge is alcohol, of course, and other illegal drugs. And alcohol is a challenge. Why is it a challenge? Because alcohol has the ability to go straight to your mind, to your brain. And their choices and their decisions made by the mind are disturbed, they are altered, they are corrupted by the alcohol that you take. So I want you to know that every bottle, every sip of an alcohol is not a fight for the body, is actually a battle for the mind. That's why I want to advise you, stay away from alcohol. Stay away from alcohol. If you need help, seek help so that you stay away from alcohol. Yes. Doesn't matter whether no one sees you, but your mind is in trouble. The other thing that is true about the battle for the mind is lack of self-discipline. Yes. If only you can have this self-discipline, you succeed. Young people, I want you to know that I have taken a deliberate step of studying people that are successful. And I have discovered that all of them, Christians and non-Christians, have one thing in common: self-discipline. And you got it right, self-discipline. Not just discipline, but self-discipline. If you lack self-discipline, if you lack from your mind the self-discipline, you will not succeed in your life. And it is this self-discipline that will help you to be focused in your life. It is this self-discipline that will help you to have values in your life, things that you treasure, things that now even, define who you are, things that you treasure. It's these life values that you will have. And once you have self-discipline, then these life values, you will cherish them, you will keep them. Values such as determination, values such as hard work, values which are really, really good, such as perseverance and so on. If only you could have these values, then it shall be well with you. Battles for the mind. The other thing that I can mention here is self-esteem. You need to have this self-esteem in your life. You need to know that you're a child of God. And allow me to mention that one other challenge that the young people are facing on the battle for the mind is actually peer pressure. Their peers telling them to do something different. Peer pressure. And I want you to know that indeed, when we talk of battles for the mind, we cannot fail to mention the issue of corruption and integrity. Young people, how we pray that you can be a child of God who is known by one thing, that young man, that young lady is honest, has integrity. You can try this and that, but she's not there for sale. He's not there for sale. He's of integrity. And how can you be a young man and a young lady of integrity? Well, you need to start by redefining yourself. Number two, you need also to have a mentor in your life, or should I say mentors in your life. Number three, you need to know that the Bible declares in Romans 12 verse 2 that do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You can only be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So I want you to know that it's possible for you to renew your mind. I want to leave you with this, that hey, even as you are faced with this challenge of the battle for the mind, remember one thing. Remember your identity. Who are you? And I want to tell you now, you're a child of God. And he loves you very much. And 1 Corinthians 15 verse 57 says, he will give us victory through Jesus Christ. It is my prayer today that you will know that with all these challenges that we are faced with, there is victory in Jesus. You shall be victorious and you shall be an overcomer by the grace of God. And so today I want to say, may God richly bless each one of you young people in Woodlands Conference and keep hope alive. Jesus loves you. We love you so much. And you are children of God. Thank you.
ali kwenda muhibi nona gasi ayanyiga Yesu wanditambula
Yes. yenile.
Greetings to all of us that are listening and watching. The theme for our series is Now is the Time. That will be the general theme for this series that we will be talking about. And our text is Romans chapter 13, reading verse 11 to 13. Romans chapter 13, reading verse 11 to 13. And for this moment, our title for the sermon is Please Wake Up. Please Wake Up. Shall we just read Romans chapter 13, verse 11 to 13? And do this, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than we first believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Therefore, let us cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the day, not in revelry, not in drunkenness, not in lewdness and lust, not in strife and envy. Please wake up. The book of Romans, as we may know, it was written by the Apostle Paul, and there are very limited arguments against his writing of the book. We understand that the letter was actually written from the city of Corinth on his third missionary journey as he went on preaching. This could have been probably in the winter of AD 57 or AD 58. The letter was written in anticipation for him going to the city of Rome, where a church had been established and they had not been there. He was anticipating that after this journey to Corinth, he will find time to go and visit the city of Rome and also the church that has been built there. But there were issues that Paul had been briefed by the brethren that were in Rome about how the city is growing up in Rome and how the church is growing up. And from the writings of the text that we are reading, I think we will need to put in context, why then does he write to a church that he has never been to remind them that they need to wake up, as if he had seen something wrong with them? First of all, if we read Romans chapter 12, verse 1 to 2, we'll begin to get an idea why he's coming out in that way. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2 says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Verse 2, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, and that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So, in one of those letters, he writes that he would desire the brothers and sisters at the church in Rome to be people that can sacrifice their own bodies, sacrifice themselves by the mercies of God to remain pure so that God will accept their service. That means something had gone wrong in the city of Rome, and most likely in the church, that people were not regarding the services of their body as belonging to God himself. In other words, probably they were not holy enough, according to him. So he tells them, do not be conformed to the world. So he brings in worldliness. That means, being a big city, most likely worldliness had taken over the city of Rome, and most likely the church as well. Now when we read Romans itself, verse 13, verse 14, it tells us something also. But put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lusts. So the waking up call is actually a call for them to wake up from the lust of the world and the lust of the body. That was his main aim. And when you look at the city of Rome during the time of the writing of the book of Romans, and during the time that the churches were being built around Europe and Asia Minor, when you go to Rome, the city, Rome, the house churches where the church at Rome was is believed to have been about 25 to 30 kilometers away from the city, where there was a kind of, if we were to relate it to these days, a kind of a mall where people did business and they lived in there, and in there there were houses where they made churches. And one of those churches was the church that Paul was talking about. And you can read these house churches in Romans chapter 16. And so most likely, some historians think that actually the house church where the church at Rome was about 25 to 30 kilometers away from Rome itself, on the right on the sea, on the sea banks, because Rome itself is away from the sea. But these house churches, many believe that they were actually built on the seaport, where people would come and immediately find business, and people lived there doing business, and churches were built there. In any case, even if you believed that actually it was in the very city, Rome, Rome was not, in terms of the activities Paul is talking about, it was not very different from the seaport, even where it is now. So therefore, he places this writing in a way that you would understand that therefore the church that was built in Rome then was built in a city where pleasure was the order of the day. And the people that were repenting were not just Romans or, if you like, Italians. These were people from everywhere who were doing business in Rome, Rome being the capital city of the world. And therefore, many of the pleasures that were happening in the city could find themselves inside the church. So the question, therefore, that necessitated this writing is that churches, for some reason, behave like the way they were built, wherever they were built, whichever city they were built in, there is a kind of behavior they behave like that. So he, at least for Paul, from the reports he received from the brethren at Rome, he thought that some of the church members were worldly. They were overtaken by the sins of the city. They were enjoying the life of the city. They were not showing a difference between them, who were Christians, and the heathens. And therefore he says, they must know the time. They must begin to realize what time they are living in. They must begin to realize and make a difference between them and the heathens around them. And so, when you paint a picture of Rome then, or at least where the churches were, you would want to agree with him that if it is true, the church at Rome was built at the seaport, away from the city itself. And when you look at that area where they consider that probably it could have been there, the pleasures that were in the city have been painted around that kind of a mall. The bakeries, the shops, the drinking places. You can all see, although it happened several years ago, you can all see they have left them the way they are. And the church, actually, or the house where this church is thought to have been, is still standing up to now for those historians who believe it was there. Some historians don't believe it was there. It could have been right in the city. It is there. Therefore, Paul had a reason to worry about the church, if that is correct, and it is correct. He had a reason that the people in the church at Rome, the people were bound to be captured by the pleasures of the city, by the worldliness of the city. And therefore, he needed to write a letter before he goes there to warn them of the dangers that they were in. A report that he had gotten from the brothers and sisters who were worshiping in that house church at Rome. And so he writes, please, wake up from the slumber of sin. Now, Paul had established, if you read Romans chapter 12 before this, he established some injunctions in Romans chapter 12, a kind of commandment that he had established, that if the Christians at Rome wanted to be true Christians, they needed to own nobody of anything except love. In other words, get away from the pleasures of the world that will entangle you into the things of the world. Oh, nobody, nothing except love. Do not get engaged. Do not get entangled in the things of the world. It shows that it was important for them to begin to observe the second coming of Jesus, which was very imminent, and the people had forgotten about it. It was business as usual. And he says, you are Christians because of the second coming of Jesus. You are not just Christians to meet at church for fellowship. Therefore, knowing that, He mentions in this passage, Romans chapter 13, verse 11 to 13, very, very, very important things. First of all, he mentioned about this, the second coming of Jesus. He says, this second coming of Jesus is actually of a fixed time. And he uses a very fixed word in Greek, kairos. It means it is not like a time that is moving from 01 to 24. It is actually fixed, bound by the grace of God that it will happen at this particular time. Therefore, do not live at easy, the Romans are told. You needed to know that you are living in a critical time, because when the time will come for Jesus to come, he will come. So he uses that. The second coming has a fixed time. And those who believe in Jesus must know the imminent return of Jesus. They cannot live at easy. He also says, this coming of Jesus makes you, as a Christian, to know that if you entangle yourself with the things of the world, you may not come out. Because he has not given us the debt, but he knows the fixed time. And so worldliness can actually capture you and forget about the things of the second coming of Jesus. He uses another term in the passage, which means the hour is already here. That's the Greek hora ede. The hour is already here. In other words, we are actually living in the very time that Jesus is about to come. And therefore, we have no opportunity to entangle ourselves with the world. In other words, they needed to wake up because the hour is already here. By the way, when you read almost all the books of Paul, you will find that he expected Jesus to come in his time. He didn't expect Jesus to delay up to this day. He was very sure Jesus would come during his time. So he uses words like hora ede. And you know, some Zambian languages use this word hora. They use it, meaning hour. It says the hour is here. It was time to wake up from the slumber. It was time to be out of the indulgence of sin. It was time to realize that time was no longer. It was time for vigilance. It was time to know that sleep will not help them. Now, it is also telling us, especially verse 11, that our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. In other words, he is expecting some kind of growth in the Christians. They cannot remain stagnant. They cannot remain with the habits that they had from the beginning. They must change. That's what he's talking about. Change. Realize that time has come for change. Therefore, wake up from your slumber. You remember, brothers and sisters, the story in Matthew chapter 25, where 10 virgins were invited for a wedding ceremony. And we are told that 5 of them were wise and 5 were foolish. They slumbered while the bridegroom delayed. They slumbered. Probably it's good to read that text. It's good to read that text. Matthew chapter 25, verse 5. But while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. All of them slumbered and slept. But the difference came when he actually appeared. 5 were found without oil, because the Bible describes, because they were foolish, 5 had oil. This is the situation that Paul is talking about. But it is possible to be in the church of Rome and yet miss the very important things of the second coming of Jesus because you don't seem to realize that it is important. So very,
very, very important for them. The reminder is that it is not just about going to church. It is about knowing the time they were living in and knowing what things to put off before Jesus comes again. And so he reminds them, please awake from your slumber. Obviously, the slumber he's talking about is worldliness. Wake up. Why? Because he tells them, because our salvation is nearer now than we first believed. Nearer in the sense that time is moving. And since his second coming is of a fixed nature, it will not change to wait for us to change. The time is fixed. When it is up, it is up. And then he says, and the hour is already here. Therefore, indulgence and negligence may lead the people of Rome, the church at Rome, to miss the very salvation that they came for. Therefore, he says, you wake up. Therefore, he says, it is expected that a good report must come from the church, that they're actually changing for the better. So far, when you look at the passage, it looks like those who were leading the church at Rome were worried about the Christians at Rome. Obviously, we know that the Christians at Rome were of mixed multitude. They came from everywhere. They met in a town called Rome. It was the center of business. It was the center of government. Everything happened in Rome. And you expect that their background, since their backgrounds were different, some of them did not take church seriously. Therefore, he warns them that if they are lukewarm, that is a deadly situation to be in. Because when Jesus comes again, he will not get those Christians that are lukewarm. But you know, my brothers and sisters, the major point here is, if this was true with the church at Rome, with the businesses that were going on then, and it is true, even if you go to Rome now, Rome has not changed much. The pleasures have not changed much. The city is still active up to today. And Christians have to be on the lookout. And this happened during that time. Now, if it happened during that time, what about for you and me? If the time was nearer then, several years back, how nearer is the second coming of Jesus now? If we are still slumbering in worldliness and indulging ourselves in worldliness, won't we be caught up in the second coming of Jesus? Now remember, what he says is that his second coming is fixed. It's not changing. It's not like He's waiting for people to repent. People must repent knowing that the time is fixed. He is not moving that. That one is permanent. The people that should change are those that accept Jesus Christ as their Savior. And I'm wondering how far you have indulged yourself in worldliness. I'm wondering how far you have gone off from the presence of the Lord. I'm wondering how far you have gone down into sleep and slumbering without the knowledge that Jesus actually can come any time. Now, let's read this again. And do this knowing the time, that now it is high time. Now, the knowing of the time is knowing of the second coming of Jesus. And then it is high time. That means it is actually here with us. It has caught up with us. Now, if time has caught up with us, if you are still sleeping in the indulgence of sin, you are endangering your own life. You know, it is always thought by many people that they will change
when time is near, but do we know when time is near? You know, if this was some kind of a change you can make when he appears, then you can indulge yourself. But when he appears, it will be too late to change. That's why Paul wrote like this. To those, yes, in the city of Rome, who were indulging in the things of the city. What about you living in the city? And the world is the whole city now. Everything that happened in Rome happens everywhere. You must know the time that Jesus is coming again. We must know that the hour is actually already here for the second coming of Jesus. We are actually living in borrowed time. We should have come a long time ago. And are you willing to lose your salvation because of indulgence? Are you willing to miss all the years that you have put in the church? And remember that this message to Rome was not written to the heathens, by the way. That's very, very important to remember. It was actually written to the people that were already in the church. This is not a message to those outside the church, particularly this one. It was actually written for those Christians who were already in the church, but their mind, or should we say, what they were doing, did not show that they considered the second coming of Jesus very serious. Now listen to this. 1 Thessalonians, chapter 5, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, and verse 3. For when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them, as labor pains upon a pregnant woman, and they shall not escape. Verse 4, but you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that this day should overtake you as a thief. We are not in darkness. That means we are actually, those of us that are in church, we are not fully in a sinful world, but yet we desire to sin while in the church. But the day can actually overtake us as a thief overtakes the owner of the house. My prayer is you will learn to wake up while time lingers. Because one day it will be too late. The day you are waiting to repent may not come. You will go before that day comes. So the best, as Paul suggests, is that wake up now, not when you wish to wake up, because the day is imminent and it is here. May God bless you.
Gracious Father in heaven, we glorify your name for your goodness and your mercies. What a day. A day in which we have learned how to become better single parents. In a day in which we have learned on how we can confront youth challenges. Finally, we have been charged to wake up and work for you. Now is the time, Father, that we have accepted to go and be different in the communities for the betterment of this world and the world to come. Now hold us from falling, even as we embrace the call to discipleship. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.